to us. With cramps and issues still with us, and still on the move, same Jesus. He's making us new, he's making us new. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He's still keeping all his promises. The same Jesus, the same Jesus. He's commanding the wind and the waves. His kingdom forever shall reign. We know that he's coming again. He's coming again. Oh, I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He's still keeping all his promises. The same Jesus, the same Jesus. I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. He's still keeping all his promises. The same Jesus, the same Jesus.
Amazing grace.
done for me. Let's pray. God, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you, Lord, that you're here. God, that you've come to do a good work in each one of us, God. And I pray that God, that your spirit would just flood this place. God, that we would feel your presence, Lord God, as you've come, God, to stir something up in each one of us, God, to plant a seed this morning. God, I pray that each person here would just feel your love and your presence, God, and your grace. And so, God, we just thank you for what you're going to do today in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You guys sound so good today. I can hear your voices. to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring, but I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. Not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? Above every fear, like the sun shaping the shadow. In my weakness, your glory appears. Oh Lord, I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here? All I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? Well, I'm not enough, I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. God, we lift you up in this place. God, I know that you're here, God, that you're working, God, and God, I know that you've come to minister to those that have come this morning. God, that have burdens, God, that have situations that they don't understand or that they just can't deal with, God. And God, that's why we have you, God. That's why we can look to you for our help. God, we look to the mountain where our help comes from. God, where you are, God, you see the big picture. You know what's going on. So God, I don't know who it's for. If there's somebody that just has a burden here this morning, God, that just don't understand it. I don't know why that word just keeps coming to my head. There's just they don't understand what's going on. And so God, I pray that there would just be clarity, Lord. God, that you would just give peace to those that need peace. God, that you would be able to take those things. And God, that even though we don't understand what's going on, God, that you do, and we trust you. God, I pray that there would just be a trust that is made this morning, God, that there is a connection. God, we know that you're faithful. You've proven time and time again that you are faithful. God, and I pray that you would help us not to forget that, that you are a faithful God. God, we are anchored to you. Just like we talked about last week, God, we want to live an anchored life to you, God. God, I pray that there would just be an awakening that happens in this church, God, that there would just be things that stir up in each one of us, God. God, that everything would just be, there's something different about each person that attends here, God, that's here, God. I thank you for what you're going to do in this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Last week, we talked about the anchored life. And so now we're going to go into a four-week series called Anchor Points. And each week is going to be a new anchor point, four, because like a house, you usually have four corners, and you want to anchor those points down so that the house stays in place. You can use anchors on a ship as well, whatever imagery works for you. But this week's anchor is hope, being anchored to hope. And so anchor point number one is hope. And our text today will be 1 Peter chapter 1. And so if you have your Bibles, you can have those open and ready. We'll get to that in a couple of minutes, and we'll look into it. But I want to start off by saying this. Would we be in agreement that our world seems a little angry these days? Our world seems a little fearful these days. Exactly. It is. I am trying to be mild about it. But fear is definitely running in our culture, and outrage is running in our culture. You know, we live in an age of outrage. There was a time when we could get together, disagree on something, and still love each other afterwards. One of the interesting things, there are so many self-help books going into the Thanksgiving season, how to manage your conflict in your Thanksgiving dinners. You know, if you need to have a step program to handle conflict at a family dinner, everybody at that family dinner needs to go to counselors. Either that or they all need to be slapped. I don't know. You take whichever way you like. I'm not trying to be mean, but honestly, why can't we get together and disagree and still love each other? I don't understand it. I remember growing up with family members that were cantankerous and didn't always agree together when we got together. And we might yell at one another and get a little hostile. But when it was all said and done, we still had respect for one another. We still loved one another. We still wanted to be associated with one another. Today, if you have a disagreement with somebody, if you don't agree on an issue, it's like you're disowning or divorcing that person. Like everybody has moved to the fringes. You know what happens when you get into a boat and you run from one side to the other? If you get enough momentum, you can overturn that boat without any waves. And that seems to be what it is. And you know what? Christians are no better. You can just, I'm not poking at anybody here. I know that perfection is within this room. The second you enter the doors, there is no more imperfection. I get that. But Christians, like, they run to the conspiracies. They run to the anti-governments. They run to the government will only save you. They run to this issue is only right. Whatever, you name it, it's out there. There's the middle ground. I love the middle ground. I love balance. Oftentimes, one side or the other has some good points, but maybe they're a little too far to one side or the other to really make it. It's not that we need to be centered. Sometimes one side is accurate and the other side is inaccurate. But what I'm trying to get at is if we're going to be anchored in hope, You can't have hope when you're outraged all the time. You don't have hope when you're feeling fearful all the time. That you would be so character weak that you can't listen to an opposing viewpoint and not hate the person. Or blow them off. Friends, we are called to be anchored to hope. If there's anybody in this world that needs to have hope, it's the people of God today. We are called to be the torchbearers. We are called to be the ones to bring excitement back into this world. We're the ones that are supposed to bring a reason for getting up in the morning. But so often, we fall into the same trap as the world, and we go to these issues, and we run to it, and we want to be right more than we want to care about others. We want to be right more than we want to hear truth. You can't be anchored to hope when you're in that mindset. Here's the big idea. The big idea is this, or the bottom line, whatever way you like to call it. Your life will take on a new purpose and direction the moment you anchor your hope in Jesus. The moment you say, Jesus, I'm going to stop worrying about all these things. There's good points and bad points on both sides. I'm not going to worry about all the things going on in the world around me. I'm going to anchor my thoughts. I'm going to anchor my life. I'm going to anchor my thinking. I'm going to anchor my heart. I'm going to anchor my emotions. I'm going to anchor my spirit on you and your word. The moment you decide, I am going to do this, that very moment, your life will take on new direction and new purpose. Because when you do that, you're not worried about the fleshly things. You just deal with them as they come. You don't get fearful of potential danger. You get wise to potential danger. There's a difference. There's a different energy, and there's a different power, and there's a different spirit to it. So your life will take on new purpose and direction. I know that a lot of people talk to me about they don't know what their purpose is. I don't know where I'm supposed to go. I don't know what am I supposed to do? Is this job good enough? You know what? You know, it just pays the bills, but I don't really want to go and do anything else, or maybe I do want to, but I'm not sure if I should. And there's always this, what should I do? What am I here for? You know what you're here for? You're here to express the amazing love of God the Father to a world around you. You are called to live in the wholeness, the fullness, and the blessings of God. That's what you're here for. And that's going to be expressed in a job. That's going to be expressed in your family. That's going to be expressed in your friendships. We'll take it a little deeper. That's supposed to be expressed in serving at your church. That's supposed to be expressed in giving of your time, your talents, and your treasure. That's what your purpose is. All the little mechanics that go along with that, that's just mechanics. Maybe God's calling you to be the best doctor in the world. Well, then go and be the best doctor in the world and never forget Jesus in doing your work. Maybe you're called to simply be somebody that does a trade and you're going to do a great job at your trade your whole life. But you're going to live for Jesus in there. You're going to bring light where there's often a lot of darkness in those in trades. You know, maybe you're called to be a teacher. Well, why don't we get a whole lot of born-again, Jesus-loving, blessed individuals into our school systems and infiltrate it with the love of God as opposed to the garbage of the world? Wouldn't our school system look different? But if you go into that with legalism as your faith, you're not anchored to Jesus. You're anchored to rules. And if you go in with, oh, God just loves everybody, then you go in sloppy grace, and people get shipwrecked. You know, we're called to be anchored in hope to Christ and the Word. So let's look at our text. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. We're going to read 3 to 5. He explains it really well. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Put the main thing. Praise God. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope. A living hope. We're going to come back to that. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. For us. Who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time, or end days. So we're going to look through this real quick before we give you some practical help. But I love how Peter lays this out. When he talks about stuff, he praises Jesus. He puts Christ as the center of all that he talks about and all that he is as a man. In his great mercy, he says, he has given us new birth into a living hope. New birth, or some translations will say, born again. Are you born again? You'll hear that phrase, that saying. In Jesus' day, the Pharisees, Sadducees, this concept of being born again was crazy to them. It didn't make any sense. They only saw it as a literal. They didn't see it as a spiritual. And we're called to be born again spiritually. That's what we're called to be. When we come to Christ, we're getting the old life of sin dies at that moment. You say, Christ, I want to make you my Lord and Savior. I confess my sin to you. I give it to you. I leave it at the cross so that you can wash it away. And you take up a new life, a new spiritual life. And that's why we want to serve. We want to serve God and do moral things, not because it's a checklist. We want to do it because we're so grateful to the amazing grace of Jesus, that he bore our sins. He was tortured on that cross where the way a sacrifice should never be treated. That's how heinous our sin is to God the Father. And he takes that and he takes it straight to the grave and buries it forevermore, cutting us off to the old life and birthing us into a new life. And this hope is called a living hope. A living hope. Verse 3, we're called into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus. So friends, what kind of hope is anchored in Jesus? It's a living one. It's active. It moves. It doesn't just stay still. It grows. It gets stronger. It gets bigger. It gets more pronounced. And that's what's supposed to happen in your life. When you anchor yourself in Jesus, that new life becomes bigger and stronger. And it's constantly getting better each and every day as you get closer and closer to him. And then he moves on and he says, You're resurrected from the dead. In other words, this new life is, you're born out of the dead. You're born into Christ. And into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. What's the inheritance? Eternal life. That one day when this is all over, and we're not worried about COVID any longer, we're not worried about race riots any longer, and we're not worried about prejudice any longer, we're not worried about hate any longer, we're not worried about selfishness any longer, because God has dealt with it forever, and we're in that eternal space. That's never going to perish. And we haven't even given birth to a concept of what God has laid up for his people who love him. Because God has an inheritance for you. In some, you know, if you read through scripture, he talks about the heavenly mansion that is being built for you. It's not that God wants to make a whole bunch of rich, spoiled people in heaven. It's called a reward for being humble in this life. Because you got to be humble if you're going to come to Jesus. It's pretty hard to come to God without humility. How do we know this? Because pride puffs us up. Pride says, I'm good enough. Pride says, I'm better than enough. I'm the best. Pride lifts us up where we don't really need God. Pride says, you know, I can do this on my own. But we're called into this inheritance which is kept in heaven for eternity. But God also wants to bless you in the gap, which is right now, the life that you're living on this earth, here and now. God has plans for you. We're going to look at that in a minute. But you know, God wants to bless your life. God wants to give you the best life now so that you can have an even better inheritance later. Does that mean that you're going to be rich? You're not going to find in the Word of God that God is going to make you rich. And in fact, if your desire is to be wealthy, and that's what you want God to do, you want him to be your heavenly slot machine, I have a feeling that you may be very not well off for a long period of time until you get past that. I know people who have very little, but who are more wealthy in their soul than I will ever be with my bank account. Because when you come to Jesus and you're anchored in Christ and you live that anchored life to him and you're tethered to him in a way that nothing can shake it, you have a richness that builds out of your soul, out of your mind, and out of your spirit each and every day that draws you closer to him. And it doesn't matter if you don't have the greatest car. It doesn't matter if you don't have the latest technology. It doesn't matter if your clothes are not the best in the world, the finest garments. It doesn't matter if you're not the most powerful person or if you're not the most well-known person or the most talented person. What matters is that you are right smack dab in the center of the loving will of God for your life. And that's what he says. That's what he wants for you. Because how do we know this? Who through faith, verse 5, are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed. You are shielded. God protects you from the attacks of the enemy. Does that mean that you're not going to get your boat shaken in this life? When you get out on the seas of life, you are going to have some waves. Your boat is going to go up and down. It's going to toss back and forth. You're going to feel a little seasick from time to time. That's why you need that anchor of hope to Jesus. That you know that even though it's going to get a little rough, He is going to get you through to the other side. Because God has promised to never leave us or forsake us. And that is something that you can take to the bank each and every day in the spiritual realm. So why do you need to be anchored in hope? Number one, to encourage you in times of trouble. We were just talking, using the imagery of a boat or of a ship on the seas. It's a very good image of our life. See, a boat is great on the water, right? A boat on the water is floating, that's great. You know where a boat gets into trouble? When the water gets into the boat. Why do we let the water into our boat? Well, sometimes we allow it to shake too much. Sometimes we don't follow the course that's laid out for us. Sometimes it gets damaged on a rock and it gets a leak and we don't fix it. Whatever the reason, sometimes our vessel takes on things of the world that it never was intended to take on. God wants you to make it through to the other side. He needs to encourage you in times of trouble. Does anybody ever have any trouble here? Anybody? Is anybody with me? Have you ever had any trouble in your life? Five of you are being honest. The rest of you are lying. I know that we've all had trouble. And you know something? That doesn't make you weak. That makes you normal. Welcome to life. Troubles are part of the package. You will have troubles. Jesus said it. In this life, you will have trouble. But he doesn't leave it there. He says, but take heart. I have overcome the world. If you're anchored in hope to Jesus, He has overcome the problem in your life. So we need to be encouraged. See, fear is a conduit that creates doubt and makes us blind to the help that God has prepared for us. And it really is. Fear is a conduit. It really is a conduit to doubt. And once you're into the fear and the doubting, you're not anchored to Jesus. You're not anchored to hope. Because hope says, I know that my ship is being tossed around, but I know that Jesus is going to get me through to the other side. That's a whole other mindset. But when you're stuck in the fear, it creates that conduit of doubt. I don't know if God can get me through this. I'm not sure that God can make me well. I'm not sure that God can bless me. I'm not sure that I have any gifts, talents, ability. I'm not sure that God even loves me. See, fear will do that. There's only one person or one being that works on fear, and that's the devil. Why? Because he knows his outcome. He knows where he's going. And yet he still crashes headlong into it, but he's trying to take as many with him on the way. And our bodies are frail, aren't they? If you live at all for a while and you get sick of any type, or if you injure yourself in any way, or if you know something bad happens to you, you know pretty quick that your body can be pretty frail. That can create fear. You know, fear creates doubt. And when you're doubting, you're not anchored to hope. So friends, instead of allowing fear and doubt to get a foothold in your life, build your life on the first anchor point of hope. Because hope says, oh, God can deal with that. God will get me through. I don't know how I'm going to pay my bills. I'll pray about it. God's going to make a way. He's either going to bring me a new job, or he's going to give me some favor, or something's going to happen. I have seen it time and time again in life. When you put God ahead of your problem, you'd be amazed how the solutions come to those problems. But so often we don't want to do that. We want to be self-reliant. We're going to talk about that one a little bit later. But we need encouragement in times of trouble, and fear will break that. God has made us blind, Fear has made us blind to what God has, the help that God is preparing for us. Sometimes you don't even realize that God's bringing somebody into your situation, and you're so focused on your trouble that you don't even want to talk to them because you're just so focused on this problem. And they're like, I could help you with that. No, you can't. You don't. What do you know? And I've been amazed in life. Some of the people I always thought, oh, how are they going to help me? When I finally humbled myself and let them in, I realized, man, if I hadn't let them in, I never would have gotten through this. Never despise the small beginnings of help and hope in your life. Never despise them. Love them. See, Hebrews 6:19 says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul. This was last week's verse. Firm and secure. See, fear is all about unknowns. Fear is all about having that little glint of doubt in your mind or in your heart. But hope, it brings an anchor to the soul that is firm and secure. Do you want to feel secure? Even when the seas are a little rough in your life, you need to be hopeful. You need to be put your hope on Jesus Christ, that He will get you through. You got to put your hope in the Word of God and follow it each and every day, and love on the commands of God. See, what we've gotten in, again, remember this age of outrage, everybody's on fringes? And in Christendom, what I see a lot of is people are either one way or the other. They've either gone to extreme legalism, and you got to do all the right things, dress the right way, say the right things, never make a mistake, and then that's good. Or you got to go to the sloppy side where, oh, God just loves everything, and so I can just go and sin like the devil. But in between there, we've forgotten the commands of God. Even the Ten Commandments. The moral law of God, which is summarized in the greatest commandment, which is, you know, the mission of this church, to love God, love people, make disciples. The greatest commandment is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then love your neighbor as yourself. That summarizes the Ten Commandments. But yet, sometimes we need to break it down a little bit more. Why don't you fear God? Don't go into those sinful things. Don't watch things that numb your heart to the sin that you're watching. Sometimes there's just sinful things on TV or on media that we shouldn't watch. Maybe there's a certain way you're thinking that, oh, this is okay, that's not so bad. But it goes actually counter to what the Word of God says. Well, then follow what the Word of God says. But don't do it as a checklist item. Do it as, I couldn't be brought to do that or accept that because it would dishonor Jesus, who gave everything for me. See, that's what happens. See, following the commands in the Bible, we're not talking about Levitical law, Jesus filled those, but the moral commands of Jesus, you know, paying to Caesar what is Caesar's and paying to God what is God's and serving with your talents and your time and saying no to lustful things of the flesh. You're not doing that to get right with God. You're doing that because you're already right with God. And it's a whole other mindset. And that brings encouragement because you realize your hope is tethered to Jesus. Your hope is anchored on Him. And you don't want to do the sinful things because you don't want to bring dishonor to your Savior who loves you so much. See, do not focus on the darkness around you. Focus on the light of Jesus inside of you. I think sometimes we get into these storms of life and into these troubles and these trials, and we're so focused on how dark it is around us that we're not realizing that there's the light of Jesus right there inside of us. And we choose the darkness over the light because it's so much bigger at times. And the light seems smaller, but the light is so much more potent. See, a little candle can get you through the blackest night. One little flame off of a candle, you go into a pitch black place, one little light from the candle, and you could walk very safely all the way through the evening. No problem. But yet we focus on, well, it's dark in that corner. I don't know what's there. And you try to shine the light and you can't see all the way into the corner because the light goes only so far. But maybe God doesn't want you to go to that dark corner. Maybe God wants you to stay where the brightness of the light is. See, if you don't focus on the light of Jesus inside of you, you're just going to focus on the dark around you. And that will definitely break your encouragement. You won't have that hope because you're so focused on the other things. The second thing, why you need to be anchored to hope, to help you trust God's plan for your life. God has a plan for your life. I want you to know God has a plan for your life. God says, I know the plans I have for you, to give you a hope and a future and to bless you. God wants to bless your life. If you think that God only just wants you to be a good moral person, that's a part of it, but He wants to shower you with His blessings. And don't think for a second that if you aren't seeking and chasing after Jesus that He won't bless you. He will. But don't think that He's going to shower you with blessings if you walk in disobedience. Your soul may still be secure, but your life is starting to go a little haywire. You're allowing a little bit of that water into your boat. So friends, please, Understand that God has a plan for your life. Spiritual hope is based on trust in biblical promises, not our personal wishes. Hey, I wish to be a millionaire. Who doesn't? Jesus, I'd love to be a millionaire. That'd be great. I can pay for everything. Wouldn't have to worry about it. Good to go. But that's precisely the problem. Sometimes it's good to worry about it when you give it to Jesus. You worry so much that you say, you know what? I need you to help me through this phase or this problem or this lack. And then God can pour out blessing that you don't have room to contain it. See, we're called to be blessed so much that we actually splash out on others around us. And if your cup's a little empty, may I encourage you to get back to hope, to trust God's plan for your life. Because when you do that, I guarantee you, your cup will start to flow. It'll start to fill up. And it's going to start to splash on others. And that impact is going to change a community. See, the Lord delights in those who fear him, who put their hope in his unfailing love, Psalm 147. God delights in those who fear him and put their hope in his unfailing love. This is Old Testament, and it talks about God's unfailing love. Don't say to me for a second that God doesn't love. God is full of love. He is the essence of what love is. So much so that sin was so vile to him that he would send Jesus himself in the form of Jesus to come and save us and rectify the sin issue in our life. If that's not amazing love, there is nothing else left to talk about. See, John Maxwell says this in regards to trusting God's plan. Where there is no hope in the future, there is no power in the present. What's our future? We talked about at the beginning. It's that inheritance. That is something we have to look forward to. What is the gap that we're living in right now? What's the hope there? That Jesus will never leave us nor forsake us. That he'll always walk by us when we stand with him. You know, there is no hope in the future, there is no power in the present. How come you don't have power right now? You don't have any hope that God is going to get you through to the other side. And then the last thing you need to do is you need to break the habit of self-reliance. This is why you need to be anchored in hope. If you're not anchored in hope, you've got to be self-reliant. You've got to be a self-made man. You've got to be a self-made woman. You have to. You have to rely on yourself, because if you don't have God, there's only one other person, and that's you. You could try to rely on others, but how many people have had somebody let them down in their life? It happens. We're imperfect, but Jesus is the friend that sticks closer than a brother. He will never leave you nor forsake you. He will never let you down. He will gird you up in the Holy Spirit and the power of his word, and he will get you through to the other side. But you got to be anchored in that hope that he will do what he says he will do. You see, I'm not worthy. Look around the room. Look at this guy here. None of us are worthy of anything. We're not worthy. But what's so great, he loves us anyways, that he would send Christ Jesus to die on the cross for us, for me, and for you. That's what makes us worthy, because God says so. Self-reliance inhibits the power and the blessings of God from being released in your life. Don't allow it to inhibit you any longer. Stop relying on yourself. Humble yourself and say, Jesus, I know what I want to do, but what is it you want me to do? Even Jesus exampled this, because the night before he goes to the cross, he asked God, can you take this cup away from me? I don't want to do this, God. I want out. And if he had stopped there, he would have been weak. But he follows it up by saying, not my will, your will be done. Friends, can I encourage you today to let God's will be done in your life? Don't rely on yourself any longer. Give everything you have to him. Get rid of the pride. Get rid of the self-reliance. And give it all to God. Because like Romans 15:13 says, may the God of hope, the God of hope, the God of hope, not the God of fear, not the God of shame, not the God of self-reliance, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and all peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with the hope. How? By the power of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the game changer in your life. When you've come into a right relationship with God, and you confess your sin to him, and you line up your thinking with the Word of God and with Jesus, that Holy Spirit gets unleashed in your life, and you can conquer mountains. Because you're so anchored in hope to God through Christ Jesus that nothing can beat you. And that's what we live for. We live for now that Jesus will get us through, but we also live for the future that one day we're going to walk through the gates and God is going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. The sweetest word you will ever hear is that day when you walk through and he says, well done. Well done. We're not worthy. We couldn't do it on our own. We fail at left and right all the time. But when we dedicate and make ourselves anchored to him, we're still going to walk through that gate one day and he's going to say, well done. And that's what we live for. We live for the hope that one day we get to hear those beautiful words. I'll follow it up with even saying this. Not only will he say, well done, I believe he'll say, well done, my son. Well done, my daughter. My child, my kid. There's nothing more amazing than when a parent showers their love on you with appreciation for just who you are in him. That will change your life. And so friends, if you're going to be anchored in hope, you need to understand these things. We need it to be encouraged. We need it to help us trust God's plan. And we need it to break the self-reliance so that one day we can walk through those gates and hear the words, well done. And in the meantime, he can empower us with the Holy Spirit to get things done right here in this beautiful city and this amazing region, in this really sweet country called Canada, that we could be light, hope, and salt to our community, our nation, and our world. Because I don't know about you, but I'm ready for revival. I'm tired of COVIDs. I'm tired of fearfulness. I'm tired of sicknesses. I'm tired of diseases. I'm tired of people being stuck in their extremes. I'm tired of people feeling defeated. I'm tired of seeing people feeling hopeless, and I am ready to lead a revival. And if God is willing to raise up a few of us here to go out and lead in our country with this kind of hope, it will cause a revival. An awakening will take place in the city of Vernon and beyond. I don't know about you, but I want to be part of that. It's not because of me, and it's not because of any one of us in this room. It's because God wants to do something miraculous through us. And when you're feeling the empowerment of the Holy Spirit on your life because you've lined yourself up and anchored in Jesus, it's the most amazing thing you will ever experience. You can never run from it. Why would you want to? Why would you ever want to go back to the sinfulness, the hopelessness, the defeat, when you could stay in line with the power and love of God in your life? Let's pray. Jesus, thank you so much for what you have done on the cross. And Lord, we need to anchor our lives in the hope of Christ, what you have done for us. We need to anchor our lives on the hope of your word, on the promises of your word, on the truth of your word, and on the remembrance that one day we're going to get to walk through those gates and hear those words, well done. So Lord, I pray that we would lead a life that's anchored in you, starting with hope, that we would get rid of fear and worry and doubt and all those things that make us fearful and self-reliant and self-interested. And we get rid of that and say humbly, I want to be anchored to you, Jesus. I want to be anchored in that hope that you're going to get me through. You're going to get my ship to the other side. And when the waves toss me and the water starts to get in, you're going to help me bail it out. You're going to help me make the repairs. And you're going to help me stay on course. Because you promised to never leave me or forsake me. So Lord, I pray that blessing on each and every one that's here today, that the anchor of hope would be so firmly fastened from this day forward, Lord God, that they would see nothing but you in all that they say and do. And God, when the enemy strikes and tries to attack, they would overcome by the power and the presence of Jesus in their life. And they'd be encouraged by the Holy Spirit to push on and keep on keeping on in the hope of Christ. So Lord, I pray your blessings on everyone that's here as they go this week. May they lead that light into their community in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.